Good. So, Carlos already ruined or showed my surprise. Well, you see, it's not working at all. Ah, okay. So now we are back. Did you remove it? No, just a little bit is missing. Okay. Okay. So. So this is the second part of these three lectures on where the main goal is somehow to study PDEs with singular interactions. And the second lecture is of more abstract nature. So after having recalled yesterday, let's say, basic properties of symmetric and self-adjoint operators and their spectra, we are now entering extension theory for symmetric operators using a more recent concept of boundary triples, which is kind of designed for PDEs. So I'm recalling the main definition which we saw at the end yesterday. So the starting point is the following. We have a densely defined symmetric operator in our original Hilbert space H, and it's no restriction to assume that this operator is closed right from the beginning. So then we shall say that a triple consisting of another Hilbert space G, which we will view as a kind of boundary space. This is the space where the boundary values live. Such a triple consisting of a Hilbert space and two more linear mappings, boundary mappings you may say, we shall call a quasi-boundary triple for the adjoint if and only if the following properties hold. So first of all, this G is Hilbert space, no problem with that. Gamma 0 and gamma 1 are linear mappings, and that is an important issue here. We fix some operator T, which for the moment is not really determined. There's some flexibility. We fix some operator T, which is a core of the adjoint. So T may be the adjoint, but it can be smaller. However, T is not too small. So if you take the closure of T, it is supposed to be the adjoint. So our boundary mappings are acting on a slightly smaller domain than the adjoint domain. And on this domain, we require the following properties. So first of all, this boundary space shouldn't be too big. This is kind of reflected in this item here. The range of this mapping should be dense in this product space. This item here is a kind of Green's identity, which is in a way the most important point in this definition. So on the left-hand side, you see the inner products in the original Hilbert space H. And now by Green's identity, you transport information of the functions in the domain of the operator via boundary values to the boundary space. So here's the inner product in your Hilbert space G. And this identity we require for all those fg where it can be meaningful, so for all those fg in the domain of T. In fact, on the domain of T, the two boundary mappings are defined by construction, so to say. And then there's another condition, which is also a kind of maximality condition. So this T, which is almost the adjoint, contains something self-adjoint that is not satisfied automatically. So we need to require it in this definition. So if we restrict T by the first boundary condition, that is something like Dirichlet, then we require that this operator is self-adjoint. Okay, and there is a kind of toy example for that, and this is also the example where this whole definition comes from. And I'm going to repeat it, although we saw it yesterday. So here is the PDE example.
Quasi.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Where's the quasi from? Give me a few minutes. I'll comment on that. So you could give this definition also without the quasi, and in that case, the T is to be a star. Yeah. So the quasi comes from the fact that the boundary maps are not required to be defined on the full adjoint domain. So it's a slightly weaker thing, so to say, and it is just fitting to PDEs, that's the point. For ODEs, we shall see this as well in a few minutes, you won't need all that. Okay, so let's come to the PDE example. We saw it yesterday. So let me consider the Laplacian. I put the potential here, although it's of no influence for the whole thing, except that it should be real. To simplify life, I'll make it bounded. And about our domain omega, I'm not too precise now for the moment. It's a bounded domain with smooth boundary.
like that.
Okay, so first of all, I fix the symmetric operator, and the one we fix here is the so-called minimal operator in this context. So it's defined on all H2 functions. So Sobolev space H2, we discussed yesterday very briefly only. So it's defined on all H2 functions where the Dirichlet trace and the Neumann trace both vanish. So this operator is kind of very small. We have lots of boundary conditions. So in fact, one can check that it is an infinite dimensional restriction of a self-adjoint operator. Yeah? You take Dirichlet and then you put another condition. So it gets very small. So this will be symmetric. You can verify it's closed. And its adjoint is the so-called maximal operator. Defined on all L2 functions, such that minus Laplacian plus V applied to F in the distributional sense is L2. And this is the peculiarity in the PDE case. You see, there is no Sobolev regularity here, no regularity up to the boundary. The functions in the domain of the adjoint are really kind of from the maximal domain. They need not belong to any Sobolev space of positive order. And that's why the T is useful. So the T should be a little bit smaller, and a convenient choice for the domain of T could be, for example, the H2 space, which is strictly smaller than the maximal domain. And on this space, we have a well-established theory of boundary traces, and we know their properties very well. Okay. And then we discussed yesterday that a possible choice, and this is a non-unique choice, for such a boundary triple in the present situation could be the following. So as boundary space, you expect the L2 space. It should be the L2 space because Green's identity transports the L2 inner product on the domain to the L2 inner product on the boundary. So G somehow should be L2 on the boundary. And for gamma 0 and gamma 1, there would be many choices, but one that comes into your mind here most naturally is probably the one where gamma 0 is the Dirichlet trace and gamma 1 is the Neumann trace. And if you check Green's identity, then you observe that you need a minus sign here in order to make it work, which is not very essential, of course. Okay, maybe I'm not going to repeat now the full discussion. Of course, this is the Hilbert space. Of course, these are well-defined mappings. You may define them on the Sobolev space H2. Yes? Oh, sorry. Just interrupt me.
If the power potential non-real,
yes?
We lost the symmetry,
yes,
operator. Can we say something about that?
Yes, that's a different issue. If you have a non-real potential, then, of course, the S is not symmetric, but then you could put an S, V-bar here. And then you could deal with so-called dual pairs of operators. So then this one would be contained in a dual operator where you have a complex V, and you could extend this boundary mapping concept to such dual pairs and move on further. But that's a different issue. Yeah? But in principle, the techniques of boundary mappings, of course, they are not restricted to the symmetric case. But we shall only be interested in the symmetric one here. Okay, so I'm removing the bar here. So if there are questions, just interrupt. Yeah? If I'm busy at the blackboard, you just shout and say stop. Okay. Okay. So this is the Hilbert space. These are boundary mappings, well defined on H2. How about this range condition? We saw it yesterday. You see, gamma naught loses a half order of regularity. So if you map H2 functions and you take traces of them, you end up with the whole H3 half on the boundary. Here you lose more. Here you lose 1.5. So these here will be in H a half. And actually, it is known from classical trace theory that the range of this combined map would be H3 half on the boundary times H1 half on the boundary, which is dense, no problem at all. So this abstract Green's identity is just classical Green's identity. It is all working well as long as you are on the Sobolev space H2. And this very last condition on the self-adjointness, that will also work here. Why? Because if you restrict your operator T by this boundary condition, now I make it 0. Yeah? So we are in the kernel of gamma naught. So I make it 0. So that's Dirichlet. And Dirichlet is known to be self-adjoint in the H2 setting, if the domain is smooth. Okay, so this is kind of the toy example for this abstract definition. Now there is another example which I should probably show you, although it is not really of importance for the following course. So here's the one-dimensional counterpart. We discussed it yesterday only very, very briefly. So I'm going to repeat it. So let's look at the one-dimensional counterpart of this whole thing. So here is minus second derivative plus, let's say, some real potential V. And, well, I'll deal with the regular case now. You could do it with the singular case as well on the half line or whatever, depending on the quality of the potential. Again, I'm not worrying about integrability of the potential or something else. I just make it bounded to have no problems at all. And real, of course, to keep the thing symmetric. So then the minimal operator that appears in Sturm-Liouville theory in this particularly simple case is defined on all H2 functions on the interval, where you have Dirichlet condition as well as Neumann condition. So that would be the closure of this expression if you define it on the test functions. So this is a symmetric operator, and again, you see, you have kind of too many boundary conditions. It's not self-adjoint, it's too small. We have Dirichlet and Neumann, that's just too much. Okay, if you take the adjoint of this one, then of course you expect the same operator, that's all fine. And you see, here is the striking difference to the PDE case. In that case, the adjoint has the same Sobolev regularity. You lose it here. You see, this is not H2 anymore. But in the one-dimensional case, there's no problem. And when I'm now looking back to this definition, I could choose T to be equal to S star. So in this situation here, I pick T equal S star. Actually, there's no other choice, because T should be an operator with closure being equal to S star and containing something self-adjoint. So in this kind of finite defect problem, there are only kind of four dimensions where you vary domains. There is no need or no possibility to choose another T than the adjoint itself. Anyway, so here T you choose as S star, and then the typical choice for such type of boundary mappings would be the following. So first of all, your boundary space will be C2. That is all the flexibility you have with boundary values in that case. And as gamma naught, you may take Dirichlet. And as gamma 1, you may take Neumann. And I think we need, again, a minus sign at one of the components in order to make the typical Lagrange identity work. And probably there's not much need to discuss these properties. So of course, C2 is a Hilbert space. Gamma naught and gamma 1, these maps are well defined on H2. You can form these vectors, of course, no problem with that. This density condition is now even better. It will map onto. So any vector in C4 you may hit with boundary values of an H2 function. This abstract Green's identity is just the integration by parts formula. You plug it in, and you just verify that it fits. And what else there is? Okay, the last one in a way is not necessary, but in any case, if you restrict S star by these two boundary conditions, or by this boundary condition, making it zero, then of course you have Dirichlet. So that will be a self-adjoint operator. Okay, so this is the ODE example, where the main difference is that you don't have to worry about the T at all. You can just take the adjoint and everything is fine. The main difference in the PDE case, and that is the one we will be interested in, is we have to be careful in our choice of the T. And now let me add a few general remarks to this definition and some simple consequences before we then move on. Okay. So probably this ODE example can go. I'm not returning to it. Okay, so I have a couple of remarks concerning this general definition. So what there is to say, what we should really note. Well, if you are able to choose t equal to s star, as we just did in the ODE example, this quasi is kind of not necessary, which connects this concept with a more well-known notion, the so-called ordinary boundary triple. Then is, I'll put it here, so-called ordinary or classical boundary triple. And I'm not going to put the definition down. It just reduces to the standard case, which probably not all of you have seen. But this is a theory that dates back to the 1970s. It comes from the Ukrainian-Russian world, where people were dealing with this type of abstract boundary mappings for the case that T is equal to S star, in order to treat ODE problems, as we just saw in this example. Yes, please.
Just a question on the literature.
Yes.
I remember that in the book of Schmidtgen, there's
yes.
a section on the...
Oh, this is very good point.
No,
the Schmidtgen is without the quasi.
Okay.
Yes. So there's a lot of literature for the case without the quasi.
And where's the quasi explained well?
Well, for the quasi it's difficult. There are some papers scattered around. I could give you references, but for the moment, let's not go into the detailed list of it. Yeah. Yes?
Is it possible to construct a boundary triple in the ordinary sense for PDE equation?
Yes. So we are getting now quite specialized. So if I would drop the quasi here, that would mean T and S star would be the same. So that would be S star now, and these things here would remain quite the same. Here, of course, you put S star. Now you would require this condition to be a little bit stronger. It should map onto, and not only having a dense range. Then we would be in the situation of so-called ordinary. Okay. So now the question is, for PDE, can I construct ordinary boundary triple? The answer is yes, because ordinary boundary triple always exists. That one can prove with abstract methods. But the disadvantage is, there is an ordinary boundary triple. You can make it even explicit, but it's the wrong one in the sense that you don't have the right boundary maps. So these boundary maps, and I claim that is what you wish to have in PDE problems. You want to measure, let's say, or describe operators via pairings of Dirichlet and Neumann boundary values. These boundary maps you cannot use for an ordinary boundary triple. And the reason for it is that this Green's identity cannot be extended all the way to the domain of the maximal operator. Yes?
So what is the relationship with this boundary operators to the elliptic boundary operators, for example, with this Lopatinsky-Shapiro boundary condition?
Oh, Lopatinsky-Shapiro, you don't need to worry about in a way. Yeah, this is just concerning ellipticity. I mean, we somehow start with an elliptic case right from the beginning. It's then a question which of the extensions will be elliptic in the sense of Lopatinsky-Shapiro. Yeah? So this you cannot immediately see in this abstract theory here. Yeah? But somehow you can circumvent the problem of ellipticity because we are kind of viewing it as an extension problem. So let me come back to this a little later. Okay, so once more to make a long story short. An ordinary boundary triple can be constructed in the PDE case, but then you need different maps. The disadvantage is that you do not parameterize operators with natural type of conditions, like Robin or whatever. Okay, it's back. Good. Okay. Anyway, I'm happy to report more about these relations between these concepts. But then it gets rather specialized. So when you have met boundary triples in your in the past, then it is most likely that you have met the ordinary ones. And just in a few words, it is inconvenient to use them in PDE problems. Okay. So that's why I'm sticking to this quasi situation, which is kind of, I try to convince you, fitting to the situation. So a few more remarks. So the T in the definition is not unique. So you can play with the T, not very much. You can play with the T as far as follows. You need to satisfy this condition, and you still need to keep the T big in order to satisfy the self-adjointness of this one. So in the PDE situation, for example, you could play with the T a little bit. It should, of course, act like the original operator. There's no way around that. But you can play with the domain. So I'll try. So let's make the domain more smooth. How about H4? Rather strange choice. But let's try to make the domain more smooth. That would still satisfy this. But then problems appear elsewhere. Any idea where? What would go wrong if I make the domain very smooth suddenly? I could do even worse, yeah? Come on. We go here for C infinity. What goes wrong? You see, the Dirichlet then goes wrong. Huh? You will not have self-adjointness of Dirichlet if you restrict C infinity functions by a boundary condition. So you cannot go down from H2, actually. You see, I put the H2 here again. Even if I just add a little epsilon, done. Yeah? Dirichlet has no better regularity than H2. But we could go in the other direction. Why not put a minus epsilon? That would work if the epsilon is small. So we could become a little bit more singular. It would still be fine with the trace maps. No problems with this. You have to be careful, of course. Green's identity should remain valid. So you have to be careful with the images of the trace operators. Yeah? Do you run out of L2? Then one needs maybe a dual pairing or something. But anyway, there is a certain flexibility for the T. I'll go back to H2 anyway. So what else? Yeah, some more things, and I'm afraid my time is too short to prove them. It's not too difficult, but, well. If you take T and you restrict it by both boundary conditions, at least in the examples you see that very well. So if you restrict T by both boundary conditions, so you put Dirichlet 0 and you put Neumann 0, well, you see, at least in the example, you end up with the S. And that is a general fact. So if you restrict your T by both boundary conditions given by the boundary maps, you end up with your symmetric operator. So the situation here is kind of the following. We have a symmetric operator. The symmetric operator S will be a restriction of the self-adjoint reference operator A0. The A0, by definition, is a restriction of the T. Well, T is a restriction of its closure, which is equal to the adjoint. So this inclusion of operators is kind of implicitly contained in this definition. A symmetry with a self-adjoint extension, with an extension given by T, which when you close it up is the adjoint. That will always be the situation when you have such a quasi-boundary triple. So then I should maybe also add that the QBT exists if and only if S admits self-adjoint extension in H. One direction is trivial. If you have a quasi-boundary triple, then they're not a self-adjoint. But you can prove the way back as well. if there exists a self-adjoint A naught, you can always construct by abstract methods such type of boundary maps. We will not use them. So I'm not going to prove the converse direction. And now, what is such a QBT good for? QBT useful for parametrization of extensions of S. And by nature, it will be naturally restrictions of T. And how we do it is the following way. We consider T. We had already one restriction by the first boundary condition. And now we kind of mix boundary conditions. So we restrict T to the kernel of gamma naught minus B gamma 1. And this B for the moment is just a linear operator in your boundary space G. And what we end up with here is we call AB. So we are restricting our operator T on H2 by some boundary condition, and what you have here is something like an abstract Robin condition. Yep, Hermann, please.
Question concerning both points. Actually, yes. How does this fit together with Neumann extension here? I could just choose the efficiency
space. Yes, you could.
And then I guess,
you could. You could. But then, of course, you see, what is Neumann doing? He's using unitary maps in between the deficiency spaces.
Yeah. So this gives you a more explicit way.
Yeah, the problem, of course, you can apply Neumann to PDE, no problem with that. But the problem is, if you do so, then you will characterize all self-adjoint or whatever extensions, but not by boundary conditions. You see? For Neumann is using the defect space and unitary maps in between. I wish to have boundary conditions. So I would like to see combinations of Dirichlet and Neumann boundary values.
That just makes it more explicit.
I mean, sure.
I mean, I can calculate the deficiency spaces.
You could.
Typically, they will be of this type, I guess. I mean, they will be the boundary spaces.
No, the deficiency spaces will be spaces of solutions. Right? The deficiency space is a space of solutions.
Yeah.
But what you could do, and we will somehow see it implicitly, if you take this deficiency space, you could take boundary values of solutions and then identify a deficiency space via a certain isomorphism with an L2 space on the boundary. But then you run into the same problems because the deficiency, the solutions, have no regularity. You see? If you just solve this PDE, so I'm talking about that one. So deficiency space, let's take point I. So you solve this PDE in the L2 context. Then you don't get any information on the F. That's the bad thing. Yeah? So this F that you get here as a solution, of course it's in L2 when you solve in L2, but it's not in H2. It's locally H2. But even when the boundary is good and you do not impose a boundary condition, such a solution is not H2. This is where all the trouble comes from. You don't have H2 regularity up to the boundary. I don't want to lecture on regularity theory now, but you see, it's often mixed up. If you put now here another boundary condition, like Dirichlet, if you solve this boundary value problem, then you are in H2. Also, I could put Neumann, that's fine too. But if there's no boundary condition, there's no H2 regularity of solution, which means there's no good working trace theory, which means deficiency spaces admit rather general functions that are difficult to identify via traces with the boundary space. You could play with defect functions in H2, and that's what we are kind of doing, yeah? Circumventing von Neumann. Okay. Let's come back to this AB over there. So the abstract idea is we describe extensions of S or restrictions of T, if you look at it, via mixing boundary conditions. And then, of course you may do it, but the question is, what is it good for? The general philosophy, of course, is knowledge on B I may have. That is the problem which I start to investigate. I have knowledge on B. So what it implies for AB? Okay. Okay, and I think now I will remove this definition. Probably we will not be using it now in all detail all the time. Okay. Well, so here's a lemma, which is a kind of warm-up. So we are in this situation. We have a closed symmetric operator. We assume we have such a quasi-boundary triple given with T, A naught, and so on, and so on. So this will always be the starting point now. Now suppose that your B is, let's say, a bounded, everywhere defined operator in the boundary space. And suppose it is self-adjoint. Then it follows that AB is symmetric. This is a warm-up. Okay. And why is that? That is actually very easy to see. We shall do it. So in order to see that something is symmetric, I should show it's contained in its adjoint, but yesterday we observed that it's also fine to check that this expression is zero for all f and g in the domain of AB. So we take some f and g in the domain of AB and we consider this difference. Okay, I'm doing it very slowly. So A and B is a restriction of T. So instead of AB, I could write here TFG minus FTG. Now I'm using this abstract Green's identity that we have available due to the quasi-boundary triple. It tells me that we end up here in the boundary space with this pairing. But now you see, F and G are in the domain of AB. What it means? It means that gamma 0 applied to F is the same as B gamma 1 applied to F. Right? So F, G in the domain of AB, it means that gamma 0 F is B gamma 1 F, and of course the same thing for G. So why not use that? Now I need to do it the right way. So this gamma 1 f I will keep here, but gamma 0 g I would like to replace by b gamma 1 g, and here I'm doing it in the same way on the first entry. So this is b gamma 1 f gamma 1 g. And now you see if this b is self-adjoint or symmetric, it makes no difference. I assume it is bounded anyway. So I could flip this b from the first entry into the second and the two cancel. Using self-adjointness of B. So if I have a bounded self-adjoint operator in my boundary space, it gives me a symmetric extension AB. This is kind of immediate consequence. Let's return to this example here. So let B suppose B is a real-valued function alpha. So I put here alpha is a function in L infinity R, L infinity on the boundary. So this, if you view it as a multiplication operator, will be a bounded self-adjoint operator in the L2 space on the boundary. No problem with that. So this lemma tells us that A alpha, which is this expression with the domain given by f in h2 omega. And now we have boundary conditions as follows. So how is that? Gamma 0 f should be b gamma 1 f. So we have Dirichlet trace is equal to, now it comes with the minus sign because there's a minus. Minus alpha times Neumann trace. So if you consider Rodin realization of your Schrödinger type expression. This lemma here tells you that this guy is symmetric. You would be able to observe this yourself, not using this abstract concept at all, because you just check symmetry by using the Green's identity in the PDE situation. And now comes the interesting point. If you look at Robin operators with some real valued coefficient alpha, then usually you do not even think and you say it is self-adjoint. This is obviously a weaker statement. And the surprise is it, you won't get it better. So this operator in general is not self-adjoint. So first of all, one can show that this opposite implication is wrong. No, maybe I shouldn't put it that way. So it does not follow. That's what you wish to have. By considering a bounded self-adjoint boundary condition parameter, that does not give you a self-adjoint operator on the original Hilbert space. In the Robin case, it means that, I should be careful. What I'm trying to say is, under these assumptions, alpha bounded real-valued L-infinity function, this operator A alpha here is always symmetric, but not necessarily self-adjoint. So if the alpha has no more smoothness, this will not be a self-adjoint operator, even if the domain is bounded with a smooth boundary. So one has to be actually very careful when doing extension theory for PDEs, because one is working in certain type of regularity spaces which may be too small for self-adjointness. So a Robin realization of the Laplacian in this domain on H2 is not necessarily self-adjoint, even though the alpha is a very good function.
In which condition
then
this operator is self-adjoint?
Yeah, this is a good point. So there are two ways to repair it. And we will see a little bit later in the abstract setting how to make it. So one way to get it working is the following. We make the alpha a little bit more smooth. That would work. But if you think of, I'm not speaking of form methods here, but if you would define this operator by quadratic form, you could, of course, do it with an L infinity alpha. Then the problem here is the H2 regularity. So if you keep the alpha L infinity, you need to go back from H2 here. What would be a good space, I think, is something like H3 half.
Other condition, it is connected with a priori estimate.
Yes. That is the same, so to say, yes. So we need better regularity here. Less regularity for the domain, yeah? Sure, sure, sure. But if the alpha is L infinity, you will have these a priori estimates only in this topology, but not in H2. That is kind of the problem. And that is why I was telling there is flexibility in the T. So sometimes it can be good to make this T a little bit less regular. Anyway, if you are in the H2 setting, this lemma gives you symmetry, and there are counterexamples for the self-adjointness. And in the Robin situation, it ends up with this type of observations. Yes, yes, please.
Just a comment. If you were using ordinary boundary,
yes. Yes.
You would get this implication.
Yes, 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 yes. This is very good comment, in fact. So. If we would use this more restricted thing, like ordinary, then this implication would be true. And it is a nice implication. You would be happy to have a kind of result that if you plug in a self-adjoint or a dissipative B or whatever, then the corresponding extension has this property. So why I'm not using ordinary? Well, because for ordinary, that would give other boundary conditions here. You see, if I would rewrite this as an ordinary thing, then that would be a different type of map. And then we would have a different, actually not a Robin type condition. And then, of course, it would be self-adjoint, but it's a different operator. Okay. Okay, we move on. Staying in the abstract setting of having a quasi-boundary triple given. So then I would like to recall from yesterday's lecture, we had a small lemma, I think it was on the bottom of this blackboard here. It was telling you that if you have a self-adjoint operator and an extension of it, which could be the T, then there is a direct sum decomposition of its domain, which is actually the case that we have here. So domain of T, we could write as the domain of this reference operator A0 plus direct sum with this space of solutions or defect space T minus lambda. And this direct sum decomposition that was working for any lambda not in the spectrum of the self-adjoint reference operator. So at least it is working on both complex half planes, on the real line, maybe parts. We don't know about the spectrum of A0. How was this operator A0 defined? It was actually the restriction of T by the first boundary map, by the first boundary condition. So the domain of A0 is nothing else than the kernel of this first boundary map. So this decomposition can be rewritten in this situation here as the direct sum of the kernel of gamma 0 and this defect space. And in particular, it then tells you that if I take this first boundary map, let me call it abstract Dirichlet, and I restrict it to this space, then it is invertible. And that leads to our next definition. So if I consider my first boundary map, my abstract Dirichlet map, and I restrict it to the kernel of T minus lambda, then it is invertible because I just removed the kernel of it. So I can take the inverse. And this inverse I will call gamma of lambda. We could do that for any point lambda which is not in the spectrum of the reference operator, because for any such lambda we have this decomposition. And then we shall view this as a function of lambda. And we will call this object the so-called gamma field. And then there is a second object, which I would like to call M of lambda, and it does the following. First of all, it is the same action as the gamma field. So I'm restricting my Dirichlet map to this kernel, so I have an inverse. Well, the inverse, of course, it maps back into this kernel. In particular, this kernel is in the domain of T. So I could apply my other boundary map to it. So what I'm doing is kind of my abstract Dirichlet trace admits an inverse, and to this inverse, I'm applying my abstract Neumann trace. So it already gives you an idea that this is something abstract Dirichlet to Neumann. We can do it again for any lambda in the resolvent set of A0. And this guy we call the so-called Weyl function. Or you may call it Titchmarsh M function, or Titchmarsh Weyl M function, or abstract Dirichlet to Neumann map. There are many different names for it. From the Ukrainian literature, this Weyl function is coming from. Okay. Some remarks how we will view these objects as operators. So first of all, of course, formally, you see, the gamma lambda, well, it maps from the boundary space to the original Hilbert space H. But it is not defined on all of the boundary space, but it is just defined on the range of this Dirichlet map. And it maps to where, well, actually the values will be solutions or defect elements. So you will end up in the kernel of T minus lambda, which is the subspace in your original Hilbert space. And how is the situation with the M of lambda? This is really a type of boundary integral operator. It is acting on the boundary space only. Why is that? Well, first of all, you take the inverse as the gamma field. You are starting here in the range of gamma naught, which is the dense subspace of G. You go back in your original Hilbert space, in fact, in this kernel, but then you apply gamma 1 to it. So again, you are back in the boundary space. In fact, you are back in the range of gamma 1 even, but this we also view as a subspace of the boundary space G. So the M of lambda, for any lambda, is a linear operator in your boundary space, whereas this gamma lambda is a linear operator from the boundary space in your original Hilbert space. So what do they do in the PDE example?
Just for the name, if you do this for the ODE example,
yes,
you get back wire function.
I think that is where the definition originally comes from. For ordinary boundary triples and thinking of a singular Sturm-Liouville problem, that would give you the Waltz-Marsh-M function. So that's where the wire comes from. Okay. So let's come back to this PDE example. So what do these two objects actually do in this particular situation here? Okay. So how was that? The range of our first boundary map, that was just H3/2. And now the gamma, you see, it somehow solves an abstract boundary value problem. So gamma lambda phi for some phi in H3/2 is the unique solution in H2 of the following boundary value problem. So first of all, it maps into the kernel of T minus lambda. So this gamma lambda phi solves the equation minus Laplacian plus V, F is equal to lambda F. This is just telling you you are in the kernel of T minus lambda. So it's a solution. Well, but what type of solution? It's a solution where if you take the abstract Dirichlet trace, you end up with this vector you plugged in. So it solves the following problem. So for any lambda not in the spectrum of the Dirichlet operator, which is here the reference operator, this boundary value problem here for phi in H3/2 admits a unique solution. And this solution is gamma lambda phi. And the fact that it admits a unique solution, this we have even proved. Yeah? And why is this solution unique? Well, it comes from this decomposition. It has nothing to do with PDE. The fact that this problem has a unique solution is due to the fact that we have such a decomposition of an operator domain. The uniqueness comes from the fact that there is an inverse, so there is injectivity in the game. Okay, so gamma lambda is a solution operator for boundary value problems. And what is dm lambda doing? I'm just looking at the definition now. You see, m lambda is apply the second boundary map to gamma lambda. So apply the second boundary map to this solution. So M lambda phi. Here is the second map. Yeah? This will be the Neumann trace of the solution F. So give me a phi in H3 half. I give you a unique solution of this boundary value problem. And now I take the Neumann trace of it. And this is the action of my M. So it is doing Dirichlet boundary values of solutions to Neumann boundary values, up to a minus sign, which I'm not kind of referring to. So this is a Dirichlet to Neumann map. And it is well defined. For any lambda out of the spectrum of this Dirichlet operator. So the Dirichlet to Neumann map, in fact, here is considered as a lambda-dependent function, so an operator-valued function in your boundary space. Okay, so these two abstract guys appear very naturally in PDE. Yes.
Question. What
please.
Are the features of classical Weyl Fitchmark theory transposed to this framework?
Yeah, good point. So, what are the features of classical Weyl Fitchmark theory at all? Well, in a way.
Well, for example,
yeah. Okay. Limit circle, limit point classification is something you don't have in PDE. That's this has well. There are papers, I know, Pearson. No, there is this one paper by Pearson and the other guy where they were trying to mimic a Titchmarsh-Weyl limit point, limit circle situation for PDEs where kind of spheres are growing.
But you can also say that if you're essentially
self-adjoint yes?
on C0 infinity,
yes?
it mimics
limit point at infinity. Okay, Fritz, with this I agree. But the problem is, we are not essentially self-adjoint on C0 infinity because we have a boundary. So on C0 infinity, we are far from being self-adjoint. If I close up my operator on C0 infinity, then I have this minimal guy.
No, you need some boundary to be, you have to have an unbounded domain. If your omega is bounded, I don't think you can do it.
No, but I'm not aware of an analog of limit point, limit circle classification via this type of energy-dependent Dirichlet Neumann map. There were attempts in this direction, and something could be proved. There is one paper pointing in this direction. But there are other features of Titchmarsh-Weyl theory. Now, Titchmarsh-Weyl theory in the ODE case. Like, let me, for example, recall the Titchmarsh-Weyl M function, it gives you a classification of absolutely continuous spectrum. So it tells you that whenever the imaginary part of the Titchmarsh-Weyl M function has a positive limit when you approach the real line, then there is absolutely continuous function, absolutely continuous spectrum. Of course,
So if you look at, I don't know, so are you basically telling me that this M here allows you to calculate the resolvents? It shouldn't be an element.
Yes. Well, the M is closely connected with the resolvents. We shall see that. But. Let me say one or two more sentences. So many of the things that you are doing with the classical Titchmarsh-Weyl M function, which is the scalar Nevandenner function or Ries-Herglotz function, continue to hold for this energy-dependent Dirichlet Neumann map. And a good example for is it characterization of absolutely continuous spectrum. So I can see with the help of this M where there is AC spectrum. I can exclude with the help of this M singular continuous spectrum. I can detect with the help of the M embedded eigenvalues. I can describe isolated eigenvalues as poles of this operator type functions.
Of which operator?
Of M of lambda. So you see, first of all.
No. But you want to say something about some self-adjoint extension?
Yes.
Which one?
Okay, Yeah, good point. The reference operator A0, but then also for any other. But then I have to modify the M. Yeah? So if the M reflects the spectrum of the reference operator, and if I have another self-adjoint extension, like AB, if it would be self-adjoint, then I would need to consider M of lambda minus B inverse. Yeah? That is the proper voltage mass function for that extension. We shall see a few elements of that. Now the bad thing is I have used already 1 hour, and this was regarded to be the introduction of today's lecture. So you have not even seen the theorem, and you have not seen its proof. Okay, I will not speed up, but I will skip proofs, which is a pity, but time is just too short. I think it makes more sense to discuss these elementary concepts in detail, and then I could provide you proofs, but time is just too short. Okay, let me collect a few properties of these operator-valued functions. So, and I'm looking first at the gamma field. So this gamma of lambda, well, it is defined on a dense subspace of the boundary space, it maps in your original Hilbert space, and it's a bounded operator. And because this is a dense subspace, you can then take the closure. And the closure will be an everywhere defined bounded operator from G to H. What else I have? I'm usually viewing this as a function. And if I do it in the strong sense, then these functions are analytic. And here, of course, the phi is some element of the domain of gamma lambda. So these solution operators, depending as a function in the spectral parameter, are holomorphic on the subspace or on the set of complex numbers where they are defined, which is a large set, obviously. Well, this is just to show you what they do. Probably you have seen these type of formulas in other contexts elsewhere. So you can jump from one spectral parameter to another. So the solution operator for the energy mu, can be complex energy as well, is connected with the solution operator at the energy lambda, well, basically via the resolvent of this abstract Dirichlet operator. And then there is the last one. The first item is kind of clear. You see, if you take an adjoint of a bounded operator, which has an everywhere defined bounded closure, then of course the adjoint will be bounded. That is pretty clear. And we have an expression for this adjoint, which is important for us. If I apply this adjoint operator, which now acts from the original space into the boundary space, then it is gamma 1 applied to the resolvent of this reference operator. Okay. Okay, so I have 4 items. I don't want to prove all of them. Some of the proofs are technical and not too interesting at all. But because it is fun, let me have a look at the last one. We shall be using this identity as well. So I wish to prove that the adjoint of gamma lambda or gamma lambda bar is given by this expression. So let's try if we can do that. So I would like to compute the adjoint. So phi is some element in the range of gamma naught, that is where this gamma solution operator is defined. And this h is an arbitrary element in our Hilbert space H. So I would like to compute the adjoint of this guy. So I'm starting like that, and my aim is somehow to shift it to the other entry, right? So let's see how we can do it. Well, if h is an arbitrary vector in the Hilbert space, and lambda is in the resolvent set of the reference operator, then you can hit this H with the K. So there exists K in the domain of A0 such that H is equal to A0 minus lambda times K, right? A0 minus lambda is bijective. We are in the resolvent set. So let me put it here. Gamma lambda phi. And here we have A0 minus lambda k. So this, in fact, is two inner products. One is gamma lambda phi, A0 k. And the other one is minus. And now I'm taking this lambda and I'm shifting it into the first entry. So this is lambda bar, gamma lambda bar, phi, comma, k. Okay. Let's do some modifications here. The A0 is a restriction of T. So I could put the T here. Certainly k is also in the domain of T and they act in the same way. Gamma lambda bar. This is a mapping into the kernel of T minus lambda bar. So gamma lambda bar gives you a solution at the spectral parameter lambda bar. So this entry here is nothing else than T applied to gamma lambda bar phi. You see, it gives you a solution. You are in the eigenspace of T at the point lambda bar. Okay, now when you look at it, you can almost see Green's identity. It's just the other way around, you see. So there is TK, well, we had in Green's identity T, F, G minus F, TG. And here you see it again just with different signs. I'll put it on the board. So take a minus out, and then there is T, gamma lambda bar phi, this is the second inner product, comma K, minus gamma lambda bar phi TK. Like that. Now I'm using Green's identity. So it remains a minus here. And now I'm getting gamma 1, gamma lambda bar phi, gamma 0 k, minus gamma 0, gamma lambda bar phi. And here is gamma 1 k. Good. Now what we know? Well, k is in the domain of our reference operator. That was just the kernel of gamma 0. So this element here, this boundary value, that will be 0. Yeah? K is in the domain of A0, that is the kernel of gamma 0. So this one is vanishing. So the first inner product is gone. Now how about the second one? So gamma lambda bar, that is by definition the inverse of gamma naught. So if I'm applying gamma naught to it, I will get back the phi. So on the first entry there is a phi, and in the second entry there is gamma 1 k, and this minus sign here cancels with that one. Now the k is closely connected with the h. So why not take the inverse of a naught minus lambda and replace k here by a naught minus lambda inverse applied to h. Okay, and now you look at this identity. Here is something, and here is something. This is true for any phi in the domain of this operator. So, by the definition of the adjoint, for the moment we do not even know that this is bounded here. By the definition of the adjoint, H belongs to the domain of gamma lambda star. Well, and if you apply gamma lambda bar star to this h, you get the second entry over there. So it shows you this formula, but it tells you much more. We can do this for any h. Uh-huh. So the domain of this adjoint is the whole Hilbert space. Then you remember that the adjoint is a closed operator, and it is defined on the whole space. So then there is the closed graph theorem available that tells you that if you have a closed operator on a closed domain, it will be bounded. So the closed graph theorem tells you that gamma lambda bar star is a bounded operator from H to G. This, of course, also tells you that its adjoint, which would be the closure here, is bounded as well. Okay, so this is kind of little exercise. It is only playing with definitions and Green's identity. But anyway, if you go back to the PDE situation, that tells you quite a bit. So if we go back to the PDE situation, it tells you the following. This solution operator here that assigns to a given boundary value a unique solution, this is bounded in the L2 context. That comes automatically. And also this operator here, which is the Neumann trace of the Dirichlet resolvent, is bounded in the L2 context. And that has, again, nothing to do with PDE. It is all from the abstract operator theory that is behind. Okay. Okay. So then there is a similar proposition collecting some properties of the M function. I'm not going to prove any of these items, but at least I should show them to you. So what is important for us? So the M function, we have seen it in the examples already, is a Dirichlet to Neumann type map. So this equality here is obvious. So it maps. It maps Dirichlet traces to Neumann traces. So whenever you work with solutions, it maps the corresponding boundary values onto each other. And that it is well defined, which is at all not trivial, is due to this decomposition. What else I have? Now let's look at this M of lambda from a more operator theory point of view. What properties it has? It's a linear operator in the boundary space. It maps a dense subspace into a dense subspace. But in fact, it can be a rather bad operator in the sense that, for example, it can be unbounded. I'm collecting a few things. So one good item is that M of lambda satisfies some symmetry condition. So M of lambda will be contained in the adjoint of M lambda bar. In particular, this inclusion, that's a consequence of Green's identity again, this inclusion tells you that M of lambda is closable as an operator. So M of lambda admits a closure. Well defined. This M of Weyl function is closely connected with the gamma field. And these type of formulas scatter around in the literature. So if you look at M of lambda phi minus M of mu, I should be careful here with the signs, phi, this is connected with the product of the gamma field and its adjoint as follows. And that's true for any phi where you can apply the 2 to. So any phi in the range of this gamma node. Sometimes you find these identities in very old papers by Krein and others, where they speak of so-called Q functions and use this as a definition of a Q function. So it is formally the same thing, except that our functions here, they may be unbounded, non-closed operators. I'll show you one more identity, which is maybe interesting. M of lambda, you can view as a constant operator. Of course, mu is in the resolvent set as well. Plus something which, up to some terms, basically is the resolvent. So I give you the right formula, but you should only look at one item here. Lambda minus mu bar. Now here's the important thing. And it continues with gamma mu. So this real part can be an unbounded operator. Yes, m of mu plus m of mu star on their common domain. And the domain of m of mu star is actually bigger than the one of m of mu. So even this real part requires, of course, some attention. So this possibly unbounded. But if you view it as a function of lambda and you fix mu, then this is a kind of lambda-independent unbounded part. But the rest is better. You see, gamma mu star is bounded. We have seen it. Gamma mu admits an everywhere defined bounded closure and itself is bounded too. The resolvent is bounded as well. So this lengthy term here, this will be bounded. I'll put here just bounded. So the Weyl function in our situation here may consist of an unbounded constant part and some holomorphic bounded function, which more or less is just the resolvent of the reference operator plus some operators that kind of connect your original Hilbert space with the boundary space. So this is the solution operator, and here is its adjoint going back. And now maybe this is now worth to spend a minute on your remark. So what has this M to do with the resolvent? Well, of course, you can see here an identity, but what it is useful for. You see, by definition, this M is defined for any lambda in the resolvent set. But now let's go a bit further. Think of an isolated eigenvalue of the Dirichlet operator. Yeah? There is a real isolated eigenvalue. So this resolvent here, it will have a pole at that corresponding point. The gammas here, they do not depend on the variable lambda, and these functions here in front are of no importance. So the resolvent will have a pole. So the gamma mu star resolvent times gamma mu, you have to argue for that, will have a pole as well. So the M will have a pole. So when lambda is an isolated eigenvalue of the reference operator, M has a pole. And it goes the other way around as well. If the left-hand side has a pole.
Can the pole be hidden by the
unbounded? This is a very good question. Yes, in general, yes. The pole could be cancelled with these operators. Because these boundary trace operators kind of make the space smaller. And it requires a lot of effort to prove that in the PDE case, it does not. But in abstract theory, which is what I'm reporting on actually here, it could be cancelled. And one has to impose other technical conditions to avoid it, which are satisfied in applications. But that requires a lot of work. So in principle, the pole could be cancelled by the gammas. Yeah? But it does not happen, fortunately, in practice. The other way around is no problem. If the M has a pole, then the whole right-hand side must have a pole. And the only possibility to produce a singularity here is in the resolvent. And now you could move on with this type of considerations. You see, if you have absolutely continuous spectrum, there is certain behavior of the resolvents here. So that you should view in the M. So the message of this formula, when you move ahead, is the following. The knowledge of M in a neighborhood of the spectrum of your reference operator is as good as the knowledge of the resolvent in a neighborhood of the spectrum.
The symmetric operator, A0.
No, A0 is self-adjoint. A0 is the reference operator, which is self-adjoint. Yeah? A0 is the Dirichlet guy. For the symmetry, that wouldn't be useful. No. That is all for the A0. So, in a few words, this M function under appropriate minimality conditions contains the complete spectral data of this self-adjoint reference operator. So that is why it is an important object. Okay. Okay, so here's the theorem. And this theorem now comes back to the lemma where we proved that an extension AB is symmetric if you consider a self-adjoint parameter in the boundary space. So suppose that B is self-adjoint in the boundary space and consider the operator AB. Well, I've written it in shorthand notation. So this is T restricted to the kernel of gamma 0 minus B gamma 1. Yeah? So it is a kind of abstract Robin operator. For the PDE case, it's Robin if B is a multiplication by a real value function. Okay, so what we know so far is the following. We have proved, and that was a one-line proof using Green's identity, that the AB is symmetric. This is already sufficient to get the type of Biermann-Schwinger principle, which uses the Weil function M. So a point lambda. Now I'm considering only points in the resolvent set of the reference operator A0, which is Dirichlet, we have the following Biermann-Schwinger principle. So lambda is an eigenvalue of the symmetric operator AB if and only if, well, 0 is an eigenvalue of this operator 1 minus BM lambda. So M of lambda is the value of the Weil function at the point lambda. It's an operator in the boundary space. I'm multiplying it with this boundary condition, so to say. Yeah? So if this guy has a kernel, it appears to be an eigenvalue of AB, and vice versa. And one can say a bit more. Maybe I skip that. So this is a kind of abstract Biermann-Schwinger principle. Yeah? You kind of detect eigenvalues for your extension looking at a boundary integral operator, which is the Weil function here. But, pay attention, this is only fine as long as this M of lambda is defined. So it is only working for lambdas in the resolvent set of the reference operator. Now actually the aim is, and that's what we shall use later, I'm of course not happy and pleased with the symmetric operator. That won't be of any use. And our future goal is to kind of rigorously define PDE operators with singular potentials. And of course, I wish to have self-adjoint ones. So I'm not satisfied with the symmetry condition. And now I need to put in more abstract conditions to make this guy self-adjoint. And here is a set of conditions which is useful for us. So assume in addition that for some lambda, I'm fixing it in the upper half plane, we have the following set of conditions. So B times M lambda should have 1 not in the spectrum. And the same at the point lambda bar. I will comment on this a bit more. second condition, some mapping properties of the boundary operator, so to say. B should map the range of M lambda into the range of this abstract Dirichlet map, and the same at lambda bar. This is, so to say, a kind of regularity condition on the Robin parameter. And then there is a third condition. B should also map the boundary spaces or the range spaces of the boundary maps into each other. So this is a rather abstract set of conditions. However, if they are satisfied, the following holds. So then, fortunately, this extension is self-adjoint. And in the course of the proof, we also get an expression for the resolvent. And it is the following one. And this expression is fine. For any point in the resolvent set of the two operators. Okay. So this will need a little bit of adaption. If you watch that closely, it makes no sense. You see, M of lambda is not necessarily a closed operator, and I did not even define the notion of resolvent set for it. So I need to put closures here. These closures fortunately exist due to item 2 in this proposition. So the M function admits closures. So we need that for closures. And also we need closures here. This is for technical reasons. And if these conditions are satisfied, then it's all true. So we have self-adjointness, that is one of our goals, but then there is more, and what is more is important as well. Here is our Dirichlet operator, our reference operator. We have now a self-adjoint AB, so we have a lot of resolvent set, of course, and the resolvent of this Robin realization can be viewed as a perturbation of the resolvent of the Dirichlet realization. Now, if you think of the PDE situation, both operators kind of act the same on the original domain omega. So somehow the perturbation should be localized on the boundary, where the functions have a different boundary behavior. And this is in fact reflected in this term here. You see, gamma lambda bar star, it takes you in the boundary space, and gamma lambda takes you back. The two kind of connect the spaces. And the important object is the one here. Actually there's a B missing. The important is the inverse in here. So this is some boundary integral operator that is acting in our boundary space G or L2 on the boundary. And as long as we are outside of the spectrum or of the eigenvalues, this inverse makes sense. And the whole right-hand side is viewed as the localized perturbation of the problem in your abstract boundary space. And now it depends on, in the PDE case, sure. So you see, for M of lambda in the PDE case, so what is the M of lambda in the PDE case? To make a long story short, you take the Green's function of the reference operator. Maybe I should apply it to some phi. And this is an integral operator just over the surface. Green's function of the Dirichlet operator. So it is essentially the resolvent, kind of restricted to the surface or to the boundary. So in applications, let's say elliptic PDE, Dirac, this is a kind of boundary integral operator. The B here is, of course, a general, for simplicity, bounded self-adjoint operator. I'm not assuming anything. So the B may be non-local, of course. But if we think of, let's say, multiplication operators on the boundary, then it's a whole local thing. Okay. Okay, so the good news is we are kind of ready for lunch. My time is over. The bad news is that actually I wanted to prove the theorem, but I think I have to skip that. Okay, so
is it bad?
The proof, no, it's not too bad. It would take me like half an hour, but probably I shouldn't do it now. Yeah? So, well, you see, you need these conditions, you play with these conditions, it's kind of technical, well, and then you prove this formula. The proof is fun, but it's a pity. I'm not able to provide it. So, thank you very much.
As the applications of the boundary value problems in domain with Lipschitz boundary.
Yes, 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 yes. You are asking all the questions I was trying to avoid. Yes, sure. You can do it for Lipschitz as well. So what is the difference and what is the same? The abstract concept, of course, it doesn't care about the regularity of the boundary. So one has to pay attention in the practical realization of this boundary triple and the corresponding solution operators. You should not work on H2 if you are in the Lipschitz case, but you should work on a space of little less regularity like H3/2, requiring in addition that the Laplacian is a distribution that is in L2 when applying it to H3/2 functions. Then we have boundary trace operators Dirichlet and Neumann in the same way as in the smooth case. Their ranges are a little bit different. Dirichlet in that case would be H1. Neumann is mapping onto L2. And this type of quasi-boundary triple works for Lipschitz as well. Same properties for Dirichlet to Neumann maps. So in a way, the abstract concept, it does not care about regularity. It also does not care about smoothness or regularity of the elliptic expression. So, of course, you can work here with general divergence-type elliptic expressions with minimal smoothness assumptions on the coefficients, as long as the trace theory in the situation is kind of developed. And so for Lipschitz domains, I should be maybe a bit more precise, bounded Lipschitz domains, no problem.
So with the relation to the MacLane theory for the boundary value problem in Lipschitz domains?
Well, it's the same. But MacLean approaches it differently, of course. He is not working really via explicit boundary conditions, but you could, of course, approach all the PDE problems via form methods. That's very natural. That is even easier. Sure. So it is all the way along MacLean. But the difference here is that we are kind of focusing on operator domains. And we need, or for our purposes, it is important when really working with operator domains and boundary values to have an explicit characterization. And that is kind of missing if you approach via quadratic forms. But in the end, let's say in the far end, when you really prove practical results, now in the BDE case, you end up with the same. This is a different abstract approach via explicit boundary values.
So in this case, there are no direct Neyman-Neumann problems. Direct,
yes.
Problem. So it's only the Green formula.
That's sufficient. If you have Green's formula, you can kind of invent abstract Neumann problem here. So it is all kind of based on Green's formula. Whenever you have a PDE problem in which situation, it may be very general and abstract. As long as there is a Green type formula and a somewhat developed trace theory for it, roughly speaking, this applies. Time for lunch?
Yeah. Questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.